I saw that dancing, so you're going to have to do that when we come back in. But meanwhile, let's just greet one another, say Happy Mother's Day. It's good to be here this morning.
I should not have ran up here. Yeah, Beth.
Josh, stay back up because we're coming in with that.
You're going to come back in.
Stay back up here because we're coming in with that.
So high, it's hard to breathe.
It doesn't get any better.
I know. She said, she's Telling like, you're about to get really uncomfortable because he's so high.
Okay. Only a month.
I know. He's already head down, but he hasn't dropped yet. That's what everybody thinks, 2 weeks.
A week.
My neurologist comes in and he was like, you're going 2 weeks early.
A week.
I said, what? He was like, every kid that I've had, I've called it by the hour, exactly when she was going. And when he would be here. He's been right.
A week. I'm going with a week.
I think you should have never
It would be better timing for you if it was a week, right?
Yeah.
What? I think it would have been funnier if you just didn't tell anyone it was a week.
I don't know.
Because we'll be meeting.
Right, yeah.
Maybe 2 weeks would be better.
And I would be more comfortable. There was a lady at work. She thought it was a beer belly. She thought that I had been going to the bar too much.
What?
Yeah. And they were like, you obviously don't know Lydia at all.
Morning.
I was like, no.
Thank you.
She was like, I was going to ask if you wanted to go to the bar with me.
Morning,
there's no going like Jehovah.
Oh, yeah. Do you want to do that part?
We're working.
And these are the days of the people.
The dry bones becoming as flesh. And these are the days of your servant David rebuilding a temple of praise. And these are the days of the
tired watching those guys wore me out.
I told Jenny, I said, let's jump. She said, I'll break a hip. Good morning. Praise God this glorious Sunday morning. I see a lot of new faces out here this morning, and we want to welcome you to Maranatha Baptist Fellowship. My name's Sean Eckhoff. I'm the pastor here. If you'll open up your bulletin, you'll notice on the far right-hand side, there's a little tear-out portion. You can write your information, prayer requests, whatever your needs may be, and we would count that as a blessing. We'd have a record of your visit, and we'd know how we can better pray and minister to and for you. And everybody else, as you know, you can still fill out prayer requests. And when you tear those out, you can drop them off in the box in the back. It's called the blessed box, and we would appreciate that. So let's start this morning off with praises. Any praises this week? Amen. Much needed rain, and we've gotten lots of it.
Too much.
Amy got her test results back.
That is such a praise. Because, and it's not only a praise that it was she's cancer-free, but it was a praise because she was expecting not to get the results back for like 2 weeks, and she got them back rather quick. So praise God. Thank you for your prayers for Amy.
How'd that happen, Charlie?
Praise God. Yeah, no kidding. Well, in his defense, they got married on Mother's Day last year. So,
right.
They're both right. Vonda? Praise God. And continue to pray for her. Right. All right. Other praises. Praise God. Oh, wow. We almost had the same sort of incident. We were taking Dawson home, and a teenage kid blasted through a stop sign and turned at the last minute. So that was scary.
We were afraid it was something Dawson did.
That's scary, too. All right. Other praises. God gave us safe travel this week.
God really blessed our church on Wednesday evening. We had a visitor come down from Missouri, Jordan.
Missouri.
Minnesota. It was an M. Hey, it's been a long week. I apologize. From Minnesota. And he put on a little concert here. And it was just awesome to see the talent that God's blessed him with and that he shares it with his church, his home church back home, and came down here to visit his family and shared it with us here. It was just an awesome time.
Yep. All right. Other praises. Grant's his grandson. Proud grandma. Paige? And it was gasping. It. I told her, don't expect this getting to be alive in the morning. And boy, God showed me. Anyway.
Said, you know, he got it, and I said, I told you first, I
rescind that statement. Blame it on him.
I'll take the blame. All right. Other praises. Kenva. We serve an awesome God. Amen?
Amen?
All right. Any other... What's that? Maria says, we ask him to do something and when he does it, we're shocked. We should go, we knew you'd do it. Amen. All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Father God, I just thank you for this morning. I thank you for the rain that you've brought us all week. Lord, again, this morning I prayed for safety and for those who are in these areas of flash flooding and these areas of tornadoes. Lord, I pray for the families who have been affected by these storms in a bad way, Lord, as some people have lost their homes. Lord, we just pray that you would be with them, that you would help bring people into their lives that can minister to them and show the love of Christ, that they, if they don't know Christ, Lord, that they can see that love and come to a knowledge of you. Lord, I just pray that you continue to provide safety for these people as some of these storms come through and they're severe. Lord, we just pray safety for everyone involved. Lord, we just thank you for being who you are, being in control. Lord, it's you are in control of the storms. And Lord, we even thank you for that. Lord, we just pray that you would be with us this morning. Be amongst us as we sing praises and worship and glory your holy name. These things we pray in the precious name of Jesus. And everybody said,
Amen. Again, let's continue to worship, and we again just invite you to however you worship, you worship. If that's standing, if that's sitting, if that's raised hands, if that's quietness, however you worship, because we serve a great God, do we not? And it's all for Him that we worship this morning.
When I survey on which the Prince of Glory died, my richest gain I count but loss, and for contempt on all my pride. Oh, the wonderful cross!
made aware that there's a gray Suburban out here with their lights on. So we can have another praise and not have a dead battery. If that's your car, you might want to shut your lights out.
Not we have jumper cables. We had an interesting discussion, Bible study in Sunday school today, and kind of, as always, talked about our culture and kind of the way things are going and how we seem to be living in a bit of an upside-down world, and things have gotten a little strange and different, certainly, than what we remember growing up. But as we studied Scripture, we came to understand it's not a lot different than what was going on back then. And the things that remain the same are Jesus Christ, that He set His eyes and His affections on us, and while we were yet sinners, He died for us, and He came and lived for a purpose. His eyes were set on Calvary. From the day He set foot on this earth, His eyes were on you and they were on me. And He set His face resolutely towards Golgotha and the cross. And that has not changed. We are without hope, and we are lost in this world without that cross of Calvary. Thank you so much, Jesus, for that. Amen.
Oh,
You reign. What can I do?
Happy Mother's Day. I love Mother's Day because I love mothers, especially mine. In fact, I love most the mother I'm married to. Oh. what's that? probably something to get me in trouble. Every year I like to recognize the mothers and honor them with some sort of gift to say thank you for being a mom, because it is not an easy task, as we'll take a look at today. So would all the moms go ahead and stand? Praise God. Now, if you would, I'd like you to come forward and be recognized. And we've gotten you a little something. Being a mom, you don't always have quiet time. Nobody wants to stand by me. I'm not a mom. God bless you, Shannon. you don't always have time for yourself. You don't have time to relax. You don't have time for quiet time with God. So this year, instead of just a bookmark or something, I decided to do something that would help you relax and have that quiet time with God. So up here is Judith. you had babies. All right. And yeah, where's she at? She's a mom. come on, Lydia. She turns around and leaves. Hey, Jeremy's trying to take a big picture, and I'm not going to be in it, so I'll stand back here by dad-to-be. Okay, say cheese. All right. So we've got for each of you a coffee cup and a devotional. And if you don't like coffee, fill it with hot tea. Or hot cocoa. So if you would, come up and grab a mug and the devotional. And we want to... And Danielle! They just keep coming out of the woodwork. And Vonda. Oh, we're in trouble. All right. All right. So, come up here and collect. Oh, get yourself a coffee mug and this devotional. It's the devotional is called "Woman of God," and I hope it blesses you as you sip your coffee or tea or hot cocoa, and spend quiet time with God, because you don't always get that as moms. So hopefully this will help. Let's give them a round. Don't be shy. You can start. I would challenge all of you to guess what one of Shammy's gifts is as she hands that out to each of the ladies. Happy Mother's Day. I greatly do. I appreciate the mothers and all that they do, because I know what mine went through growing up because of my sisters. You thought it was me. So what's it like being a mom? Well, I saw this video where an expectant mother asked the same question. So let's take a look.
And right there's the heartbeat.
Do you have any kids?
3, actually.
Wow, that sounds crazy.
Crazy? In the best way possible.
So what's it like being a mom?
Mom, I ain't feeling too good.
Oh no. It's okay, Sugar Bear. Let's just go home.
Sorry, Mom.
Oh, it's okay, sweetie. Next time, we'll just run to the washer.
Why are you watching me sleep?
Because you're my baby boy, and I love you.
Still creepy, Mom.
Grounded for the rest of your life? Yes. Yes, it does. So in the future, you and I can just refer to it as the monthly visitor.
Stupid. Why am I so stupid?
What did you just say to my son?
What?
My son is not stupid. My son is smart. He was formed by God's hands. He was dreamed up by his heart. And he was placed in this world with a purpose. You, my son, could never be stupid.
What? Mom would never do something like that. She's way too predictable.
I know, right?
How's that for predictable? Nostradamus.
To do. The summer's gonna go by so fast, and we still have to pick out my dorm room furniture.
Calm down.
What?
Maybe I'm not ready to let you go yet.
Mom.
Yes, Mom. That's who I am. Is it so bad that I just want to take care of you forever?
You already have. Everything you've done for me, everything you've taught me. I'll take it with me wherever I go. You have taken care of me. For life.
So what's it like being a mom?
How much time you got?
That first scene, I don't feel so well. It brings back memories of throwing up in a shoe on the way to the bathroom. A shoe. It was the only thing I had available. But I love that video. It shows so many things that moms go through in their lifetime as the children grow up. The problem is that moms are held with such high expectations. And oftentimes, us kids, well, frankly, we beat mom up. And then there's other times where mom, she doesn't need the kids to beat her up because she's busy beating herself up. And God is chiming in. Do you hear this? So moms, they put this high expectation on themselves as well. As, you know, I could be a better mom than I currently am, or I could have been a better mom than I was, or what if I don't stand up to what a mom should be? And so there's this stress that goes on with mothers. And I don't think it ever ends, because after motherhood comes grandmotherhood. Yep. You get grandbabies. And so, what's that? So much better. But is it any less stress? No. Now today's text isn't your usual Mother's Day text. So pay attention. If you would, turn to 1 Kings chapter 3. 1 Kings chapter 3, verses 16 through 28. And I apologize, this will not be on the screen. The trip this week sort of shortened my time to do that. So 1 Kings chapter 3, we're going to read verses 16 through 28. And it says, "Then two prostitutes came to the king and stood before him." I told you this wasn't the typical Mother's Day text. "Then two prostitutes came to the king and stood before him. The one woman said, 'Oh, my lord, this woman and I live in the same house, and I gave birth to a child while she was in the house. Then on the third day after I gave birth, this woman also gave birth, and we were alone. There was no one else with us in the house, only we two were in the house. And this woman's son died in the night because she lay on him. And she arose at midnight and took my son from beside me while your servant slept, and laid him at her breast, and laid her dead son at my breast. When I arose in the morning to nurse my child, behold, he was dead. But when I looked at him closely in the morning, behold, he was not the child that I had born.' But the other woman said, 'No, the living child is mine, and the dead child is yours.' The first said, 'No, the dead child is yours, and the living child is mine.' Thus they spoke before the king. Then the king said, 'The one says, this is my son that is alive, and your son is dead. The other says, no, but your son is dead, and my son is the living one.' And the king said, 'Bring a sword.' So a sword was brought before the king. And the king said, 'Divide the living child in two, and give half to the one and half to the other.' Then the woman whose son was alive said to the king, because her heart yearned for her son, 'Oh, my lord, give her the living child, and by no means put him to death.' But the other said, 'He shall neither be mine nor yours. Divide him.' Then the king answered and said, 'Give the living child to the first woman, and by no means put him to death. She is the mother.' And all Israel heard of the judgment that the king had rendered, and they stood in awe of the king. because they perceived that the wisdom of God was in him to do justice. Now this is a classic of Scripture. But do you know what the problem is with classic Bible narratives? We often learn what the main lesson is, and then we neglect what some of the side lessons are. And they can also be important parts. This incident is used of God to show that he had given King Solomon wisdom, the wisdom that he had prayed to get and he requested as the king. And it provides that wisdom. It shows that wisdom comes from God. But the story also provides morals of motherhood from an unlikely source. The first moral of motherhood in this narrative is there is no such thing as a perfect mother. Now, I don't say this to bring mothers down. In fact, I'm saying this to help encourage mothers. There is no such thing as a perfect mother. No one needs to be treated with more tenderness than our mothers, our moms. Perhaps there's no one more caring and conscientious than our own mothers. Sometimes we're too hard on them. And like I said earlier, sometimes they're a little too hard on themselves. The two mothers in this story were prostitutes. And their babies were evidently conceived in that sin. And that kind of grabs you. That makes you sit up in your church pew. And we're talking about prostitutes in church having babies. Well, of course we are. It's in the Bible. And what else would we be discussing in church than the Bible? Now my question is, why did King Solomon even consider these two prostitutes? Why did he even have their case brought before him? Why did he care about these two prostitutes at all? They were obviously not living in God's will. Neither were the sinful men who were paying for their services that conceived these children. Why would King Solomon even care? King Solomon cared because God cared. God cares for these women. God cares for the baby that's still living. God is truly caring for the baby that died. And so Solomon was concerned about these two women because God was concerned about these two women. Now, I don't have to convince you that the church should stand for moral purity. I mean, that should be a given. We should always stand for moral purity. But the church should also stand for forgiveness and reconciliation. These women weren't living up to God's ideals. Yet, he still cared for them. If any of us had to wait for God's love, and God's love was based on our actions, we would all be in trouble. We would be in big trouble. We would be waiting, for eternity, because none of us can meet the standards that God has put forth. We can't, and that's why we have Jesus Christ. We would be in big trouble. And these women were the same way. They weren't living up to God's ideals, just like none of us have. There's no such thing as a perfect mother, just like there's no such thing as a perfect child. And though we're not all mothers, we all are children. So none of us are perfect. If there's anyone in whom we should be willing to overlook faults, it should be our mothers. And maybe you're asking yourself, well, why should I overlook the faults of my mothers? Well, just think of how many faults your mother has overlooked in you. I know how many faults my mom has overlooked in me. Now, she's still learning some of them and that she didn't know about. I've started to kind of reveal a little bit. You guys probably know a bit more about my past than my mom does at this point. She just found out, what was it, last Thanksgiving? The Thanksgiving before that? That I smoked. She did not know. But I told her. She also found out I was an alcoholic because I was able to hide that from her for that whole time. She was a little shocked. But moms need to laugh and have a good time. So here's a few good laughs for you moms. These are some excerpts from It's called the Children's Letter to God series. You'll enjoy these. These are actual, authentic letters written by children to God. Dear God, I read the Bible. What does begat mean? Nobody will tell me. Yeah, we'll have that discussion later. Dear God, did you mean for the giraffe to look like that, or was it an accident? Norma. Dear God, I went to this wedding and they kissed right in the church. Is that okay? Dear God, thank you for the baby brother, but what I prayed for was a puppy. Please send me a pony. I never asked for anything before. You can look it up. This next one, Jenny and I really got a kick out of. And we'll see if you can pick it up. Dear God, please send Dennis Clark to a different camp this year. Her dad is Dennis Clark. Just makes me wonder. Dear God, I think about you sometimes, even when I'm not praying. Amen. We should all be thinking of God, even when we're not praying. Dear God, I bet it's very hard for you to love everybody in the world. There's only four in my family, and I can't do it. Is there an amen? Dear God, I didn't think orange went with purple until I saw the sunset you made on Tuesday. That was cool. Amen. Jenny said, that's right. So next time somebody says I'm not color coordinated, I'll say, look at the sunset. So those are authentic letters that would make any mother smile. And if they didn't make you smile, find something to make you smile. Because smiles are healthy. They help you relax. Believe it or not, there's research that shows that smiles and laughter are healing. Life is too short and God is too good to go around frowning all the time. So find something to smile about and laugh. Here's another moral of motherhood from today's narrative. God has answers for a mother's problems. God has answers for a mother's problems. Don't look for stress-free motherhood, because it's not existent. Stress-free motherhood, that's an oxymoron. It does not exist. Every mother is going to realize stress from giving birth to the empty nest to grandchildren and great-grandchildren and beyond. Motherhood is stressful. And once again, this isn't mentioned to bring moms down, but to encourage you. Because God is willing and able to assist moms with any problem that they encounter. God is there with you to get you through the stress. God didn't give Solomon wisdom so folks would just stand around at the palace and say, ooh. He gave Solomon wisdom with a purpose. And God not only cared for those two prostitute mothers, but he's also loved the little baby in the story. And God dispatched his wisdom to Solomon to save a child. He has wisdom to spare for all of your parenting needs. Everything we need to know, he has given us. There is a lot to say about parenting within the pages of Scripture. He can guide and provide for mothers in all kinds of situations. Single moms, adoptive moms, stepmoms, moms with special needs, you name it. God can give you wisdom to deal with the situation that you find yourself in. Kids today have special needs. It's a strange culture for kids to grow up in. And with those needs come special stresses for moms. But God will help you through that. He can teach you what to do and what to say in every situation. It's like the mom who was tucking her small boy in one night, and it was storming, much like this outside. And she gives him a hug and a kiss goodnight. You hear him say through a shaky voice, "Mom, can you sleep with me tonight?" And she says, no, sweetie, I have to sleep with Daddy." And there was a long silence, and then all of a sudden the silence was broken by a shaky voice again. He said, "The big sissy." Yeah. So here's the third and final moral for mothers from this narrative this morning. There's nothing like a mother's love. There is nothing like a mother's love. The real mother in this story would rather see her baby be given to the other woman, would rather sacrifice her own son to let him live than to have him divided and be killed. This is love at its greatest. I love my child so much that I would spend the rest of my life without it, that he can live, even though he's living with somebody who's not his mom. I mean, praise God for this loving mother. You have to be willing to give some things up to be a good mother. And that's what she was willing to do. Motherhood comes with personal sacrifice. Moms make tons of sacrifice. How many times has mom worn the same old worn-out clothes so Junior can have the new shoes to wear to school? How many times has mom given up seconds because Junior's growing and there's just enough for one more plate at the dinner table? How many times has mom sacrificed buying something for her so Junior can have at least somewhat of a Christmas? Motherhood comes with sacrifices. Our mothers, they fed us, they nourished us, they protected us with their own bodies before we even saw the light of day. That was their first sacrifice, was they sacrificed their bodies to house us for 9 months. But like I said, it doesn't stop there. Mothers continue to sacrifice. They sacrifice with midnight feedings after the baby's born. They give up their personal goals so they can help their children meet their personal goals. We honor moms for all they give and do. Amen. I sat here when I was writing this. I was thinking back. I'm like, my goodness, I could talk till everybody just got up and left on the things that my mom did and the way she sacrificed and the way she showed unconditional love, even in the beatings. Not that she, like, bashed me, but I had family that believed in spankings, and my mom was the disciplinarian of the family. I got one spanking from my dad. That was plenty. Moms didn't hurt quite as bad, so I took more. But she did it because she loved me. And I look back and I can see that. And even then, I could see that. I'll share one story. You guys haven't heard this one. I couldn't have been more than five, because we lived on Prairie, and on Prairie I was in kindergarten, and then we moved. So I had to have been no more than five. My mom tells me to take out the garbage. Okay, I'll take out the garbage. Well, the problem with taking out the garbage was, we have this huge backyard, privacy fence wood, with a dog that I didn't really get along with. It was a big German Shepherd. I was just a little kid. I was scared of the dog. And so I didn't want to walk through the backyard to the alley, because then I'd have to deal with the dog. Well, the only way to get to the trash can in the alley then was to go out the front door, walk all the way down the sidewalk, half a block, another half a block to the alley, another half. It was a long trip for a five-year-old. And that trash is heavy. So I decided to deposit it in the neighbor's yard. And I hear this, "Hey, you!" And I look up, and neighbor's looking at his kitchen window at me. So I ran. And I ran inside, and I ran, and I hid in my bedroom door where they would never find me. Yeah, I got a spanking. But I got it because she loved me, and she needed me to know that that is not proper behavior. And boy, did I learn. So, thank you, Mom, for spanking me. Moms remind us of who God is and how sacrificial was His giving. He gave His only Son for a world of wayward children. That kind of love should not go unnoticed and unappreciated. In fact, we need to respond to moms with great love and appreciation. And then we need to double that and respond to the God who created motherhood with love and appreciation. Amen? So, today, this afternoon, take mom to lunch. If mom's not around, call mom, tell her you love her, and thank her. Especially for the spankings, if you got them. And anyway, God gave mothers a heart for their children. And mothers care for us, just like King Solomon cared for these two prostitutes. Mothers care for us, not only because we're their children, but because God cares for us. And God cares for each and every one here this morning. And like I said, we have many visitors, and having visitors, I can't know the condition of each and every one's relationship with Jesus Christ. And I've said many times that Christianity, it's deemed a religion, but it's not about religion. Religion is us trying to work our way to God. Religion is how much good can I do to earn God's favor. Religion is us focused. And that's not what Christianity is. Christianity is a relationship. Christianity is a relationship with the God of this universe, that being Jesus Christ, who came, who He loved us so much. Doyle mentioned it this morning, and that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Do you have that relationship with Jesus Christ? Because through sin, we're separated from God. Sin being lying, stealing, misusing God's name, lusting. Look at the Ten Commandments. See yourself the way God sees you. Scripture tells us to examine yourself to ensure you're in the faith. If you've done these things, James says, if you stumble in one point of the law, you're guilty of breaking all of it. The Bible says we're all sinners. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. But it also tells us that if we confess with our mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe that God raised Him from the dead, then we shall be saved. Today is the day of salvation. So if you don't have that personal relationship with Jesus Christ, might I encourage you this morning to do what Jesus Christ Himself said, repent and trust in the gospel. And repent just is a fancy word. It means turn, change your mind. It's a change of mind. I'm not going to live in rebellion to God anymore. I'm going to turn, I'm going to change my ways, and I'm going to live for Jesus Christ. Now, do you have to be completely cleaned up and pure before you can come to Jesus Christ? Oh, heavens no. If that was the case, I never would have made it. Again, that's back to religion. I'm cleaning my life up. You can't clean it up enough. Come to Jesus as you are, and He will make you clean. If you have another decision to make, maybe it's one of membership. Maybe it's of missions. Maybe it's of ministry. I don't know how God is speaking to you this morning. Whatever decision you've got to make, listen to God. Be obedient to God, even when it's hard. If you need to pray, come up here and pray and meet God one-on-one. Would you join me in prayer, please? Dear Heavenly Father, I thank You for this morning. I thank You for the rain that You have continued to send even today. Dear Lord, I thank You for mothers, especially on this day where nationally mothers are recognized for the important role that they play in this great nation. Lord, I pray that You would pour Your blessings out not only on the mothers of this nation, but Lord, I pray that You would pour a blessing out on this nation, though we don't deserve it. Lord, I pray that you would pour so much blessing out, Lord, that people would see and know that it could only come from God. Lord, I pray for revival in our country. Lord, I pray for revival within our leadership of our country. But Lord, I mostly pray for revival within me, because it all starts on an individual level. Dear Lord, thank you for this passage of Scripture. Thank you for King Solomon's wisdom. And thank you for the lessons from two prostitutes from others. These things we pray in Jesus' name.